Hi, I'm Sheila Frazier, and welcome to Women's History Month. When I was thinking of who I would talk about, I thought about a woman who I just have always admired, Shirley Chisholm.
I stand before you today as a candidate for the Democratic nomination for the presidency of the United States of America.
Shirley Chisholm was someone who I admired because of her strength, her will to do what it was that she had set her mind to do. She didn't let anyone derail her. She was just an amazing woman. She was a former vice chair of the Democratic Caucus. She was the first Black woman to be elected into Congress, an educator. She was an amazing person. But what stood out for me was just her character.
I am not the candidate of Black America, although I am Black and proud. I am not the candidate of the women's movement of this country, although I am a woman, and I'm equally proud of that. I am not the candidate of any political bosses or fat cats or special interests.
She was the first Black major party candidate for the office of presidency. Now, who did that then? In the 70s? She felt as though there was no glass ceiling. She stood for all of us who wanted to accomplish something. She did it for those wonderful Black women who are in politics today. Letitia James. The next president of the United States probably will be Stacey Abrams, a Black woman. And we all stand on her shoulders. Shirley Anita Chisholm.
Hi, I'm Vivian Scott Chew, and I'm so honored to have been asked to celebrate Women's History Month with my good friend, Juliana Richardson, and the History Makers. I've been so blessed to be an executive and entrepreneur in the music industry for some time now, but it's my philanthropic work that I am most proud of. In thinking about who my hero is, I would have to say it's my mom, Mamie Murphy, who as a single mother not only ensured that both my brother and I received the best education possible, but also instilled the importance of servitude in us both from an early age. Although she did get to witness my successes in the music industry, she unfortunately passed away before she really got to see the spirit of altruism that I learned by very simply watching how she served others. Mamie Murphy, my Sheila.
Hello, my name is Toni Fay, and I am honored to be included in the History Makers Archive. I was selected as a History Maker because of my career crossover from leadership positions in government and the not-for-profit sectors to achievements as the first corporate officer at Time Warner, once the largest media and entertainment company in the world. I would not have been as prepared or as confident in standing my ground in corporate America as an authentically Black executive driving the advancement of Black businesses, organizations, and people if it were not for the encouragement and support of another history maker and my mentor, Dr. Dorothy Irene Hite. Often forgotten in the annals of the civil rights movement, Dr. Hite was president of the National Council of Negro Women for four decades and up until her death in 2010. She was the only woman in the room or on the stage where it happened as one of the big six leaders of the civil rights movement. She was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom from President Bill Clinton and the Congressional Gold Medal at the Capitol Rotunda during the George Bush years for her service to this country. Dr. Hite was my boss at the National Council of Negro Women in the late 70s, where I served as her director of fundraising and programs, and later served on her board of directors during the time when she spearheaded the purchase of a building to house its national headquarters, just six blocks from the White House. She also was commemorated with this forever stamp that was issued in 2017. It was the 40th stamp issued in the Black Heritage series of the U.S. Postal Service. So I say, let's remember and say her name, Dorothy Irene Height. And thank you, History Makers, for letting me speak about my shero and mentor.
I'm Dr. Joyce Brown, and it is my great pleasure to greet you and to honor the glorious women who have either preceded all of us or who touch our lives and inspire us on a daily basis. I am privileged to serve as the president of the Fashion Institute of Technology in New York City.
And let's get on with the show.
Here we interact with 8,000 talented students throughout the year and try to create transformative experiences and opportunities for them to flourish and to grow and to leave their imprint on the world. Personally, I have always gained strength and inspiration from the perseverance, the fortitude, the sheer doggedness and defiance of those strong Black women who forged the path for us to walk forward and to dig new treads and directions along the way. Thanks to them, I hope I have been able to leave some imprint on the students who cross my path every day. When obstacles block my path, I'm reminded of Rosa Parks and her determination to not let the false narrative of separate but equal rule her life. From her, I have learned that it is my choice to make. Do I stay and fight, or do I simply fear failure? When I awake and I'm depressed by the state of the world or by my own inflated ambitions, I'm reminded of Maya Angelou, whose indomitable spirit soared despite unfathomable burdens. And from her, I learned to greet the morning with hope and to be thankful that we have not been given more to struggle with than we can handle. And when I simply need a dose of inspiration, I think of my dear friend, the internationally renowned bridal designer Amsala Abera, who left this world far too soon. The personification of perseverance and resilience and optimism, she was stranded in America as a student when a revolution in Ethiopia, her native land, closed her off from family and all resources. Undeterred, she used her time and talent to build a stunning bridal business from the floor of her apartment to the pinnacle of the industry. Exuding the regal grace of Ethiopia and the fierce determination of a warrior, she shared her vision with brides of every persuasion and used her gifts and imagination to transform her life. I gained strength by living in the shadow of these strong women who shared their vision, who spoke their truth, and who let each of us know that we are only bound by our own fears and imagination.
Greetings, I'm Bishop Vashti Murphy McKenzie, the presiding prelate of the 10th Episcopal District, which is the great state of Texas. And I'm the 117th elected and consecrated bishop of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. I'd like to thank the History Makers for telling and preserving our stories for more than two decades. For Women's History Month, I'd like to lift pioneering A.M.E. women in Episcopal service who have and who continue to be change agents in communities, countries, and congregations around the world. And they are the late Bishop Sarah Davis, who also served in the Presidium of the World Methodist Council, Bishop Carolyn Tyler Guidry, who expanded the church into South America, Bishop Ann Henning Byfield, who serves with compassion and competence today in churches in the Caribbean, in Europe, and in England. We stand upon the shoulders of the global mother in ministry, the Reverend Cecilia Williams Bryant, former senior supervisor of the A.M.E. Church, a prayer warrior who, with her husband, Bishop John Richard Bryant, expanded the A.M.E. Church into India, which exponentially grew. The voices of these trailblazers ought to be amplified so that our children and their children after them will be inspired, encouraged, and motivated to go and do likewise. Happy Women's History Month.
My name is Barbara Bowles, and I'm truly honored to be a History Maker. I wanted to tell you just a little bit about myself. I came to Chicago at an early age and worked for many years in banking and in the investment department in particular. After I left banking, I worked for two Fortune 50 companies, Beatrice Foods and Kraft Inc., where at Kraft, I became the first African-American vice president. Following my stints in corporate America, I decided to start my own business, and I began a company called the Kenwood Group, which is an equity investment firm, as well as a mutual fund, and the first African-American woman to do so. Most recently, I was chair of my college, Fisk University. But I wanted to talk a little bit today about, most importantly, my honoree, or the person that I think is an unsung hero, and that is Margaret Burroughs. Mrs. Burroughs and her husband founded the DeSable Museum of African American History and Culture in 1961. Mrs. Burroughs was born in the year 1915. She passed in 2010. And in those years, in between all of that time, she did many, many things. She was an active artist. She was a poet. She was a teacher and a professor. And through her museum, that is still being done.
Hi, my name is Teri Plummer McClure, and I'm honored to have been recognized by History Makers as the first African-American female general counsel of a Fortune 50 company, UPS. The African-American woman in history that I would like to recognize is my great-great-great-aunt, Nellie Arnold Plummer. Nellie was a former slave who became the first female student of Wayland Seminary, where Booker T. Washington was one of her classmates. She grew up to become an established educator in the Washington, D.C. school district, where she taught for over 40 years. But more importantly, she self-published in 1927 this book, Out of the Depths, or Triumph from the Cross. This book chronicles the trials and successes of my family, the Plummer family, from the Revolutionary era through slavery to freedom and beyond. I'm truly grateful to my Aunt Nellie for her work and for our family to have this intriguing account of our history.
Hi, I'm Sharon Pratt. I'm the founding director of the Institute of Politics, Policy, and History, housed on the campus of the University of the District of Columbia. And I suspect the reason I'm talking with you today is that I was also the first African-American woman to become mayor of a major American city when in 1991, I became mayor of my hometown, Washington, D.C. And the woman who in many ways inspired me was Patricia Roberts Harris. I was very lucky. I attended Howard University. And while I was there, my humanities instructor was Toni Morris, and my sociology professor was E. Franklin Frazier, and the Dean of Women was Patricia Roberts Harris, who later became also one of my law school professors.
I am a Black woman who even 8 years ago could not buy a house in some parts of the District of Columbia.
Patricia Roberts Harris set the bar for me and for so many others. I was so excited when she became the chair of the Credentials Committee of the Democratic National Committee during a very intense election, and later became the very first woman to be a part of a cabinet when she became Secretary of HUD, Housing and Urban Development. Just having her before me, knowing that it could be done and do it with such elegance and such grace, such resolve and such intelligence, was a source of tremendous inspiration. She expanded my imagination and my horizons.
Hi, I'm Meli’sa Morgan, R&B songstress, best known for my hits Do Me Baby, Fool's Paradise, and Do You Still Love Me? And a woman that really inspired me is Aretha Franklin, not only because of her gut-wrenching vocals, but because of what she stood for and how classy she was as the Queen of Soul. I grew up listening to her music, singing her music, and it's because of her that I think that I wanted to be a singer. So I salute Aretha Franklin, my icon.
Hi, I'm Jamie Foster Brown, and I was the publisher of Sister2Sister magazine for 25 years, and before that, I produced a show, Video Soul, with Donnie Simpson.
Legendary, superstar, immortal, musical genius. All these labels have been affixed to Stevie Wonder.
Trying to find out who inspired me in terms of me wanting to be bigger or braver, I think about Rosa Parks. I think about so many women, C. Dolores Tucker, who were really freedom fighters and were on the front line. And when I think about them, it was dangerous. It was very dangerous for them to do what they were doing. Some of them were beaten and antagonized by police and people who were just evil. And yet they continued on. They didn't stop. And so in my journey, when I had faced things that were anti-Jamie, because I'm a little bit different from the norm, I had to think about being encouraged to stay where I was and to move forward and not to be afraid and not to listen to what everybody else has to say and not to be with the norm, but be above that, to go through it, you know, go down under it to get where you're supposed to go, where God has sent you, where you know inside of your heart where you're supposed to be and who you're supposed to be.
Hi, I'm Bev Johnson, a 45-year radio broadcaster, currently hosting The Bev Johnson Show at the legendary WDIA Radio here in Memphis, Tennessee. I've been employed at WDIA for 38 years and have been hosting my talk show for 34 years.
You're listening to the Queen of Talk on WDIA.
How you doing, GK?
Don't you ever get old, girl.
Yes, I do.
You sure don't look it.
Hey, well, thank you.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome in to WDIA, the Bev Johnson Show.
It's a sound listeners have enjoyed for 46 years.
In 2019, I was inducted into the 2019 class of the Tennessee Radio Hall of Fame, the first African-American woman. My love of radio begins with hearing my mentor right here at WDIA Radio. As a child, listening to her in my teens in Detroit, Michigan. My mentor is definitely an unsung hero. She is Martha Jean the Queen Steinberg. Martha Jean could stand toe-to-toe with any man in the radio industry, and she earned their respect. Martha Jean has not only worked at WDIA, she worked at several radio stations in Detroit, and she was finally able to own her own station, WQBH, in Detroit. Martha Jean the Queen Steinberg was a go-getter, a role model, community leader, and a minister, as well as a mother. She was able to minister to her audience every day about life.
Attitude has so much to do. And you know, there's some of you who have gone and had an opportunity to get the best education in the world.
Martha Jean inspired me to persevere, encouraged me, and gave me that motherly and mentoring love I needed to sustain in this business of radio and in life. I proudly stand tall on the shoulders of Martha Jean, the Queen Steinberg.
As we celebrate Women's History Month, I would like to tell all of you one of the persons who impacted my life and made a great impression on me. Many years ago, I was at a hotel business meeting hosted by Miss Oprah Winfrey. And Miss Oprah Winfrey, you were my inspiration. From that day forth, I have really tried to live up to some of the values and the things that I heard in that meeting. That meeting was so special to me, and I've held the things that you said in my heart and in my mind all these years, because one of the things that you said was, you all are phenomenal, phenomenal, phenomenal women. And I know that that's a key from Ms. Maya Angelou, but it reflected so well with your saying it and telling us all, young women sitting in the audience, listening to your valuable words and lessons. Thank you so much for being that inspiration to me. God bless you. I love you. Take care of yourself. And I hope that one day we'll have the opportunity to meet. I am Claudette Robinson, First Lady of Motown and an original miracle. And God bless you.
Hello, I'm Shirley Pula Kinsey, proud favorite granddaughter of my first shero, Susie Plummer Pula. Proud graduate of Florida A&M University, where I met and married my life partner of 54 years, Bernard W. Kinsey, and proud mother of Khalil B. Kinsey. I've had several careers, and most recently, I'm co-founder and collector of the Kinsey Collection with Bernard and Khalil. This collection has traveled to 31 museums and one internationally, sharing many untold stories of accomplishments and contributions of African Americans in building America. Five letters in the collection that stand out to me are from Zora Neale Hurston to my Uncle James Webster in St. Augustine, Florida. They met in the 1930s and maintained a lifelong friendship. Little did I know that as much as I liked her writings and was inspired by her philosophy and outspokenness, as a young lady, I didn't know that they were friends. Upon his death was when we discovered these letters written to him and books to him, 1993. I feel now that I have a personal connection to her. She spent time in my hometown, St. Augustine, Florida, in the summers, and my high school guidance counselor, Mrs. Rosalie Gordon, who had a very big impact on my life, was friends with her also. Mrs. Gordon helped edit some of her works. So as I look at it now, my connection to her has come full circle. May she rest in peace and power.
Hello, my name is Pat Cleveland, and I've been a model for more than 50 years. I've worked with the best designers and photographers and artists. I'm not here to talk about me. I'm here to talk about Lady Bird Cleveland, the artist. Behind me is one of her paintings, and she started painting when she was in the South during the Jim Crow period in the 30s. She grew up in Georgia. And then when she came to New York at the age of 13, at 15, she won a scholarship to Pratt Institute. And ever since 1940, she has been painting, and up until her passing away in 2015. She's an unsung hero because she has painted the American experience of being African American and seeking freedom. This painting is entitled To Seek the Forbidden Dream. So I'd like to tell everyone that Lady Bird, the artist.
Hi, my name is Jessica Harris, and I am here to celebrate a woman who I very much admired. In fact, I admired her almost as much as I admired my own mother, and her name was Leah Chase. Leah Chase, or Aunt Leah, as I used to call her, was the celebrated queen of Creole cuisine who was the co-owner, with her husband, of the extraordinary restaurant in New Orleans, Dookie Chase. And she was an amazing woman. She was a woman who fed the Freedom Riders. She worked at creating racial harmony in the city that she loved, which was New Orleans. She worked at bringing art to everybody. She created a mini museum in her restaurant, showcasing black artists to people who might not otherwise have gone to museums. She did so much in her 96 years that I can only salute her. So I just want to celebrate Mrs. Leah Chase, Queen of Creole Cuisine.
Hi, my name is Kym Washington Longino. I've been a stunt woman for 36 years. I've had the opportunity to work with some of the best actresses in Hollywood, and I have been inspired, and many have made an impact on my life. As I look at the past, as I look at the present, it gives me hope for the future, for women who may want to become a part of this industry. There are women that stand out in my mind that have made an impact on my life. Those women are Cicely Tyson, Oprah Winfrey, Whoopi Goldberg, Vanessa Williams, and now Kamala Harris. We have so much to look forward to.
My name is June Jackson Christmas. I'm past president of the American Public Health Association, vice president of the American Psychiatric Association. I'm a founder of Harlem Rehabilitation Center and also a co-founder of the Urban Issues Group. And in all of these activities in New York City, where I live, I believe I've been influenced by a wonderful woman, an obstetrician, an internist, whose name was Dorothy Boulding Therapy. She lived in the early part of the 20th century, was most active in the 30s and 40s and 50s as an advocate for better health, for Black women's issues, and for improving the lot of African American people. She did it through combining her zeal and zest for improving health with her drawing upon other people from the community, from her social organizations, sororities such as the AKAs, and imploring, persuading, and guiding people like plantation owners to open up their ranks of poor sharecroppers and let them get health care. She did that in the 30s for 6 years, enlisted her sisters in the AKA, the sorority. But before then, she had started clinics and reached out into that poor community, knowing that she could help make the status of health better for people. She overcame obstacles, not being given an internship when she was at the top of her class graduating from medical school, not being able to express her views during the war time when prejudice against people protesting social discrimination and segregation were looked upon critically. She was an advocate. She was a physician, hands-on physician, had her own practice. She was also a leader of women's groups. She succeeded Mary McLeod Bethune in the leadership of the National Council of Negro Women. And she crossed over as well and was a leader in the American Association of University Women, which is interracial, predominantly white. She had the persistence, she had the creativity, she was a good, caring physician, and she was a person who said, I'm gonna try to make it work.
Hello, I'm Valerie Richardson Jackson, partner at Jackmont Hospitality. For over 20 years, I've been the host of Between the Lines and Valerie Jackson in Conversation for NPR station WABE in Atlanta. I'm honored to pay tribute today to a woman who's been an inspiration to me, my mother-in-law, Dr. Irene Dobbs Jackson, professor of French at Spelman College for almost 50 years. She was a civil rights activist who helped desegregate Atlanta's public libraries, where African-American patrons were only allowed to read books in the basements. She earned a doctorate at the University of Toulouse in France, and while studying there was married in City Hall by the mayor of Toulouse to Maynard Jackson Sr., the pastor of Friendship Baptist Church in Atlanta. 60 years later, her son, my husband, Maynard Jackson Jr., and I renewed our marriage vows in that same room at City Hall by the mayor of Toulouse. Mama Rini, as we affectionately called her, was a gifted pianist and cook. In the 1930s, when the South was segregated and racial tension was high, she and Reverend Jackson established a small family resort, Jackmont, in the North Georgia mountains that catered to African-American groups. Mama Rini's intellect, charm, and crusade for the rights of African-Americans was reflected in her son, Maynard Jr., who became the first African-American mayor of Atlanta. I was fortunate to look at Mama Rainey as a role model, as well as my own mother, Ruth Richardson, who insisted my two brothers and I integrate an all-white high school in Richmond, Virginia. And after raising 8 children and 1 husband, at 50 years old, she became a licensed nurse. Both were outstanding examples of strong, honorable women.
I was born and raised here. I matriculated at Lamont Owen College. And in fact, I'm a second generation Lamont Owen College graduate. My parents graduated in the early 40s. To give you another interesting piece of information about me, in the 1960s, in fact, 1968, during the sanitation strike here in Memphis, I was working on my PhD in environmental engineering with a focus on sanitation in hopes of making the job better and safer for the people who do the hard work in my profession.
I'm here today to talk about my favorite African-American woman. But here's the truth. My life has been graced by so many amazing women that I feel that I have to mention some of them. They start with my mama, Bernice, who refused to work as a domestic, does not remember graduating from high school, but graduated from college with a degree in economics in 1939. Her standards were high and she was demanding, but loving. There's also the women of Delta Sigma Theta sorority, of which my mom was a member. I am also a member, along with my 3 sisters. Some of the Deltas who have inspired me are Mary Church Terrell, born and raised in my hometown of Memphis, Tennessee, and was the first Black woman to earn a college degree. Ida B. Wells, a journalist and human rights activist who worked for a very long time in Memphis. Mary McLeod Bethune, an educator pioneer. Shirley Chisholm, the first Black woman elected to Congress and to run for president. Dr. Juanita Williamson, my English professor who pushed me well beyond what I thought was possible, and Yvonne Clark, the first Black woman to earn a degree in mechanical engineering. And there are more Black women that I think of often. The slave women who Dr. Marion Sims used for experiments, their suffering led to miraculous cures for injuries during childbirth. And Henrietta Lacks, who died of cervical cancer, but her cancer cells continue to live on today and have been and continue to be used to solve so many cancer-related diseases. All of these women have had a profound effect on my life. I can't thank them enough.
Hello, my name is Tanya Hart. I have been a media journalist and content producer for a very long time.
I've got to tell you, I've heard about your story, have listened to many of the accounts of what happened to you as a young man.
I built BET's West Coast operation. I have been inspired by so many great women, starting with my mother, Jean Hinton, who I refer to as the original soccer mom, because my mother would take me and my cheerleading crew to all of our games, all of our state competitions. You know, she and her family had an indelible impact on my life. And then there was also Mary Ann Shad Carey, my father's direct descendant, who was the first female in North America to publish a newspaper, and that was in 1853, the Provincial Freeman. My aunts who lived in Detroit, honey, they invented the words style and diva. And my mother-in-law, Dr. Merle Hart, was a groundbreaking educator. So I've been lucky. I have been around so many great Black women.
My name is Cleo Francine Wilson. I'm a history maker. I served from 1982 to 2005 as the executive director of the Playboy Foundation. a corporate giving program of Playboy Enterprises, Inc. I don't know if I'm typical or whether this is true of other older Black women, but I had no role models per se. My role models were the mothers and grandmothers and aunties and cousins who were all around me trying to make a way out of no way. The stellar women that I later heard about later in life seemed at that time to be beyond my aspirational grasp. So when I started looking for heroes and heroines, I went to books. And it was there that I discovered the work of Octavia Estelle Butler. She's a fabulous writer, and I was thunderstruck by her tales, her characters, her passion, and her amazing creativity. Octavia Butler was a brilliant writer, almost unknown to all but a more hardcore fans of science fiction. She was critically acclaimed and a formidable talent, but her writing is more relevant today than it was nearly 45 years ago when she began.